Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming to our in Taikyo service. And we have today a special guest, Mr. Robert Kajiwara. Thank you very much for accepting our request. And we can learn from him how to learn from wisdom, past wisdom, and what we need to pass on to the future generation. And today, also, we have Chika-san, MC, our MC. Chika-san, you are born in Okinawa? Oh, okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, madam. Hi, so let's go to the special guest. Now moving on to the special guest, Mr. Robert Kajiwara. Let me explain briefly introducing him. Robert Kajiwara is a part Okinawan, Ainu, and Native American. He is a singer, songwriter, visual artist, and human rights activist from Hawaii. He is of Yonsei, the fourth generation, from Nakamitsu Village, Okinawa. So he is a cultural ambassador of that Nakamitsu Village as well. And he is also a special envoy for Aupuni of Hawaii. He graduated from University of Hawaii at Manoa with BA in history, focusing on Asian Pacific, and has a master's degree in history from University of Nebraska at Kearney, and is currently finishing a PhD in history from Liberty University. So he's the author of Occupied Okinawa, the U.S. and Japan's Destruction of Okinawa's Environment and Democracy.
States, but this is our first real event here in Hawaii, even though we're technically headquartered here. But we would like to do more events here in Hawaii. Thank you very much for inviting me here to speak today. When Reverend Kajiwara asked me to come speak and told me the subject was on honoring our predecessors and teaching the future generations, I was very excited because those are values that are very important to Okinawan culture. And as we talk a little today about Okinawan history and culture, I think you will see those two values played out very heavily. It's such an integral part of the culture. Unfortunately, the culture, the history, the language, the environment of Okinawa is under attack by outside forces, specifically the colonizing forces from Japan and the United States. So if you see here, here are a few very popular symbols of Okinawan culture. In the lower corner here, we have children dancing a traditional Okinawan folk dance called Tantame. It's a dance about, basically, it's a fun dance about harvesting the ocean's resources. So about fish and shellfish and seaweed and things like that. That's a favorite pastime in Okinawan society, even to this day, and Okinawans have long harvested ocean resources in a safe and sustainable way. Above that, you see City Castle, which is probably the most famous building in all of Okinawa. Then you have Shishimai, or the lion dance. It's very similar to Chinese lion dance, except if you can tell, the Okinawan style of costume is quite different from the Chinese style. And then below that, you see the jinbe, the Okinawan whale shark. Okinawa and all of the Ryukyu Islands have a lot of marine biodiversity. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later. In the corner there, you see a small picture of the Okinawan sweet potato. That's a very famous symbol of Okinawa. Unfortunately, today in Okinawa, the environment, like I said, is under attack by colonizing forces. So even though the Okinawan people have eaten healthy foods like the sweet potato and taro and many others, today these foods are becoming increasingly hard to find because the land is being used for other purposes, particularly for tourism and by military bases. So the foods that have sustained the Okinawan people for hundreds or even thousands of years are becoming increasingly hard to find, and they're being replaced by Western fast food, chips, french fries, soda, candy, things that are very not nutritious. So even though Okinawans have historically been the longest lived people in the world, we're seeing the average life expectancy for Okinawans decline due to this reason. It's a very similar to what's currently happening here in Hawaii, with Native Hawaiians losing their lands and not being able to grow the foods that have sustained them for hundreds or thousands of years. Then we see next to that a picture of the goose food, but this is not the goose food from my home village. That is the work of indigenous Okinawan engineering. When the first Europeans traveled to Okinawa, they were amazed at the quality of the engineering by the Okinawan people. Above that, you see the hanagasa, or it's part of the Okinawan traditional court dance, a very famous symbol of Okinawa. And finally, in the So Aesop is a traditional Okinawan folk dance. It's popular anywhere. There are Okinawan communities all over the world, including here in Hawaii. Now, to our study of honoring our ancestors or our predecessors while also teaching future generations, Aesop is very interesting and an important part of that for Okinawans. So Aesop, when we dance Aesop, we are dancing for our ancestors. We're dancing to honor and remember our ancestors and all that they've sacrificed and done for us. As I mentioned, Okinawan culture is under attack. Okinawa was an independent nation known as the Ryukyu up until 1879 when Japan invaded and annexed the Ryukyu against the will of the Ryukyu people. Japan, of course, went on to do the same to many other nations such as Korea, China, the Philippines. After World War II, though, all those other nations were given back their independence except for the Ryukyu. The Ryukyu was the only one that did not regain its independence. Instead, it was seized by the United States and used for military purposes. In 1972, America gave Ryukyu back to Japan, and it has remained so-called part of Japan ever since. Now, the Japan government, after the annexation, outlawed the teaching of traditional Ryukyu culture, history, and language in the schools in Ryukyu. And so to this day, it remains, these things remain untaught in Ryukyu schools, meaning that students grow up today in Ryukyu without any knowledge of their heritage, without any knowledge of the history, the culture, the language of Ryukyu. In fact, it's so discouraged in Ryukyu today that many students, many children and young adults are actually ashamed of their Ryukyu identity. They call themselves Japanese because that's what they're taught at school. They're taught Japanese history and language and culture, not Ryukyu. But Aesop remains an integral part of how the young generation today retains their Okinawan heritage. So they might not know the history, language, or culture, and they might even be ashamed of it. But a lot of young people in Okinawa today, and also Okinawans all over the world, love Aesop because it's fun, it's popular, it's a good way to fellowship and to bond with other young people their age. And so, through Aesop, the young generation still retains their Okinawan heritage. So when we talk about honoring our predecessors while also teaching the future generations, I see Aesop as an integral part of that for Okinawans. In my opinion, if more people all over the world simply embrace this, this value, honoring our predecessors while teaching future generations, I think the world would be a much, much better place. So that's something I think that Okinawans can help share with the rest of the world. Next slide, please. The Okinawan culture is heavily spiritual. And if you can see this played out in almost every aspect of Okinawan society. So all across Okinawa are scattered utaki or sacred groves, such as reeds. There's literally thousands of utaki all over Okinawa. Utaki are simply just sacred places. They come in all different shapes and sizes, but they're sacred places where people go to pray, to honor their ancestors, and to pray for Okinawa, to pray for their everyday lives, to pray for their family and friends. And I know a lot of the spiritual leaders in Okinawa, they pray especially for their children, or their grandchildren, or great-grandchildren. And I know there are a lot of people in Okinawa who pray for me. And the the one in the middle here, I found while I was walking through the mountains in my village here, in Matabusu. It's probably a family, Utapi, a family altar. A lot of Utapi are like this. They're small, they're kind of hidden away. But then there are also larger Utapi, like the one you see in this corner right here. This Utapi is a famous one because it happens to be in front of Shiki Casa. The one on the far corner over there is perhaps the most famous Utapi. It's called Seipa Utapi. It's considered to be the most sacred site in all of Okinawa, where the very first Okinawan ancestors landed or arrived in Okinawa. And the one in the far bottom corner there is my personal favorite Utapi, because it's the Utapi in my home village, and I often go there to pray. So Utapi are a very important part of Okinawan society, of Okinawan spirituality. Unfortunately, some Utapi are being demolished by the United States to build other facilities. Others haven't been demolished but are simply kind of lost or forgotten. I asked a friend I know in Okinawa, she's from Okinawan, which is a pretty big city. I asked her, oh, so do you have Utapi in Okinawa? She's born and raised in Okinawa. And she said, she looked at me strange and said, no, we don't have Utapi in Okinawa. I've never heard of that. I asked another person from Okinawa, an older person, asked them the same question, and they said, yeah, we certainly have Utapi in Okinawa. Unfortunately, the younger generation just doesn't know about it because they're not educated, they're not taught these things in the schools or anything. And in fact, they're taught the opposite. They're taught that these things are stupid or shameful or just not important. So you can see that the crisis going on in the community today, where the younger generation is largely ignorant of their heritage, and while the older generation is trying their best to pass on the knowledge, but the force is coming from both Japan and the United States, much larger and more powerful countries than Okinawa. So the elders in the Okinawa community are running a huge uphill battle in terms of teaching and preserving our cultural heritage. Next slide, please. Here are a few quick examples of other sacred sites all around Okinawa. This first one in the top corner here, this is also and Utapi. Utapi, like I said, they come in all different shapes and sizes. Some are just out in the open, others actually have a little building. This is a very old Utapi, it's hundreds of years old. This building is the original. It miraculously survived the Battle of Okinawa. Even though during the battle it was horrific and almost everything in Okinawa was destroyed, this building happened to survive. So it's a very important sacred place for my village. Below that, this is the Ukwanisa, or giant tropical almond tree. The tropical almond tree is a very important tree for Okinawans. And this one happens to be over 200 years old. It was planted in commemoration in my village, right next to where I stay over there. And so this tree is famous because of its longevity. Scientists from all over the world come to study it. There were actually two of them originally, but during the battle, one was destroyed. This one miraculously survived. The picture of the beach and the ocean there, as I said before, beachcombing is a favorite pastime for Okinawans, not only as a way of relaxation, but to harvest food. It's very practical. And so you see there, is a sub-village within Nakabushi Village. These trees were planted hundreds of years ago when the first settlers of Kikisato came, and they planted it in commemoration of the start of this new village. The three trees represent the three original families moved to the village, and it remains an important and popular and sacred spot in Nakabushi to this day. And I just showed you the reverence that Okinawans have for our ancestors, our predecessors. And then finally, in the top corner, there is that's a picture of a well, a traditional and ancient well in my village. My village has done a really good job of preserving the historical sites. I cannot say the same is true for all of Okinawa, but Nakabushi, being a small farming village, has retained its traditional way of life much more strongly than, say, the city town. So the well is important because it was a life source for the village. And today, Okinawa, of course, has no plumbing, running water, so there's no need to go out to a well to get water. But before, I mentioned renewable plumbing, obviously the villagers went to wells to that every day. It was a necessary part of life. And so our preservation of these important places shows you, again, the importance of honoring our predecessors. And this picture here, that's a picture of me at my family tomb or Ohaka. The tombs are very important places, and so we go to the tomb to remember our ancestors and to fellowship, to share a meal with them in remembrance of them. Basically, our ancestors were very important. They helped make us who we are today. And to lose sight of our ancestors, our predecessors, is really to lose sight of part of who we are. If you notice the unique structure of the tomb, this is a very common traditional Okinawan style tomb. A lot of Westerners think the tomb is shaped in the omega symbol. But it's true, yes it is, but that was not the intent. The intent was to structure it in a way that's symbolic of the womb. Okinawans, we believe that when we're born physically in this world, we come out of our mother's womb. And when we die and we pass on to the next world, we go back into the world to start our new life in the afterlife. So if you go to Okinawa, you will see tombs like this all over the place, especially in the mountains. The Okinawa language has quite a few proverbs that relate to this concept of honoring our ancestors and teaching future generations. Here are just a few of my favorite. Tsui Yatakara, which can be translated as the elderly are precious treasures to us. Ukaji W, which is the Okinawan version of Okami Samade. And what I mean because of you. And perhaps my favorite, Umari Jumanu, Kufa wa Shiri ne, Kumi wa Shiri yun. Kumi yun wa Shiri ne, Yuya yun wa Shiri yun. Which means to forget one's native tongue is to forget one's native country. And to forget one's native country is to forget one's parents or ancestors. So these sayings are very important sayings in Okinawan culture. At one point, they were very well known throughout all of Kyushu. But like I said, because the So I mentioned that I started a petition to save this coral reef in Okinawa. As you can see, it's a very beautiful reef. It's said to be the second most biodiverse reef in the world, only behind the Great Barrier Reef in Australia. It's home to hundreds of rare and endangered species. Unfortunately, the Japan government is currently building a new U.S. military base, and they want to give over this reef to build this base. The reef is home to the Okinawan dugong. You see picture here. It's a critically endangered species. So the Okinawan people are strongly against the building of this base. In fact, in February this last year, they held a referendum allowing the Okinawan people to vote whether or not they wanted this base. The Okinawan people overwhelmingly voted against the base. Over 70% voted against the base. Unfortunately, both Japan and the United States said, well, we don't really care, but the Okinawan people say we're going to build the base anyway. Next slide, please. So, a lot of people think that the issue of military bases in Okinawa is a political issue. But this is actually not true. I say it's a human rights issue. An example of a political issue would be taxes. Some people believe that taxes should be increased in order to allow the government to pay for more services for the people, while other people believe that taxes should be decreased to allow the people to keep their money because no one wants to pay taxes. That's an example of a political issue. But what's going on in Okinawa today, the military base, this is not a political issue. This is a human rights issue. It's prejudice against Okinawans. Japan doesn't want the military base in Japan because they're saying not in my backyard. You know, they don't want to deal with all the negative fallout that comes with military bases. So they're saying, well, let's push it on to Okinawa. Now, Okinawa makes up less than 1% of Japan's total landmass. Yet it contains over 70% of Japan's military presence. So you can see there's a huge disparity there. So this is actually a human rights issue. It is prejudice against the minority Okinawans. And so this past July, I spoke at the United Nations Human Rights Council in Geneva, Switzerland. I spoke about this issue and I asked the United Nations to investigate the situation in Okinawa. There were a lot of positive responses at the United Nations from all sorts of people, from diplomats from other countries, from the workers at the UN, and also from non-profit, non-governmental organizations present at the UN. So we continue to pray that the world will learn more about what's going on in Okinawa and that the international community will do something to help Okinawa. So there, in my opinion, there are five critical aspects to the EQ identity in no particular order. It's culture, history, language, environment, and national identity. If we lose even one of these things, we will lose all five. That's my opinion. So as I said, all five of these things are under attack by both Japanese and American colonization. Now, in terms of teaching future generations, the U.S. military base in Okinawa caused a number of problems. It causes environmental problems. Military bases, U.S. military bases, are notorious polluters. They're poisoning the water in Okinawa, which causes severe health problems. It can cause cancer. It can cause miscarriages. It can cause kidney failure. It can cause so many problems. And that's what's currently going on in Okinawa, and yet very few people are aware of that. The military bases in Okinawa are also hotbeds of crime. Since 1972, over 200,000 incidences of crime were committed by U.S. soldiers in Okinawa. 200,000. And Okinawan society is traditionally a very safe society, where crime is very rare. So any incident of crime in Okinawa is a big deal. In America, crime happens all the time, right? And so it's really, by American standards, 200,000 incidents of crime might not be such a big deal. By Okinawan standards, it's a huge deal. It's not acceptable in Okinawan society. Also, U.S. military aircraft in Okinawa have a very high, they're very prone to accidents. Since 1972, over 709 U.S. military aircraft accidents have occurred in Okinawa. 709. That comes out to over an average of over 16 aircraft accidents in Okinawa per year. In 1959, a U.S. Air Force plane crashed into an elementary school in Okinawa, killing 17 people, 11 of whom were children, and injuring over 200 others. In 2004, the U.S. military helicopter crashed into Okinawa International University. Thankfully, school happened to be out of session at that time, so no one was injured. But had school been in session, certainly something tragic could have happened. So because of this high accident rate, it is mandatory for Okinawan school students to evacuate whenever a U.S. military aircraft approaches. So last year, in the last year alone, there were almost 700 instances of evacuation where the students had to evacuate. In 1 year, almost 700 times. That's an astounding number. Could you imagine being a student and having to run back and forth to evacuate 700 times in 1 year? It's just ridiculous. So when we're talking about teaching future generations, well, how can we teach future generations if they're literally being forced to evacuate during school? So really what is being taught to the young generation is that they're not safe. They're not safe in their own homes, in their own schools. And they're being taught that their lives are not as important as American or Japanese lives. So you can get a little picture of why the Okinawan people are so fed up with the military. Next slide, please. In Okinawa, there are regular peace demonstrations that attract thousands, even tens of thousands, even over 100,000 people. Now, the population of Okinawa is roughly 1.4 million. Worldwide, there are around 1.7 million Okinawans. So to get over 100,000 people to come out to one event, that's incredible. that's a huge number compared to the Okinawan population. So similar to what's going on regarding Mauna Kea here in Hawaii, where Hawaiians are trying to protect the sacred aina, this is what's also going on in Okinawa today. For the peace protectors in Okinawa, most of them are elderly. If you look at the pictures here, you don't see too many younger people. The elderly, because they're retired, they don't have jobs to go to. Many of them have decided to live their life, live out the remainder of their life to protect and preserve the Okinawan environment and preserve it not only to honor our predecessors, but to preserve it for the younger generations for the future. Because if they don't, the coral reef that I showed you earlier, that's going to be fatal. That's going to be destroyed. The younger generation will never see that reef except in pictures. And instead, all they'll get to see is a military waste.
So the elderly peace protectors in Okinawa, they're some of the nicest people you'll ever meet. They're very committed to peaceful demonstrations. Violence is not an acceptable concept in Okinawa, in Okinawan culture. So initially, the Okinawan police, they refused to touch, to lay a hand on their elders. They sided with the elderly peace protectors. So the Japan government instead ordered Japanese police to go to Okinawa. And the Japanese police are not afraid to be brutal to the Okinawan elderly. They're constantly mistreating the elderly. They're forcefully removing them. Some of them actually get hurt. They've gotten hurt fairly seriously. So you can see the difference in values between Okinawan society and Japanese and American society. Now, I will have to point out that traditional Japanese society is very different from this sort of modern westernized version of Japanese society. Japan is experiencing, in some ways, many of the same things that Okinawan culture is experiencing with an increase of American culture, Western culture in Japan today, so that a lot of Japanese, especially the younger Japanese, they don't really know their Japanese heritage, even if they were born and raised in Japan. Because of the heavy American influences permeating Japanese culture today. So traditional Japanese culture was much more similar to Okinawan culture. Japanese culture had these values of respecting your elders and honoring your ancestors, preserving the future for your children. That's a very Japanese traditional way of life. Unfortunately, that is being lost because of the heavy Western influences. Next slide, please. So this graph came from the Okinawa Prefecture government. If there was any doubt as to the prejudice from Japan against Okinawans, I think this graph kind of says it all. Before Okinawa was given back to Japan by the United States, you can see it was a much, it's still a very substantial amount of military in Okinawa, but compared to what it is now, it was much smaller back then. So after Okinawa was given back to Japan in 1972, Japan saw this as a great opportunity and said, hey, we can reduce our own military burden. Let's push more of the bases onto Okinawa. You can see over 70% of Japan's military forces are currently stationed in Okinawa. I do have to mention that this base that's currently being built at Honolulu is unnecessary. It's been called unnecessary by several U.S. government officials, by some U.S. military commanders, and even by some Japanese government officials. They said this base is actually not necessary for America's or Japan's security or national interest. So the question comes to, why is this base being built then? Some say it's due to the military-industrial complex. They're very rich and they pay off politicians, maybe both in America and Japan. To support their interests. In my opinion, the current Prime Minister of Japan, Shinzo Abe, wants this base built in order to keep control over Okinawa, to prevent
like to learn more about this, I do have a book out. It's available on Amazon. It's called Occupy Okinawa. I am currently working on other books. My next book is called Re-examining Okinawa's Role in Asia Pacific Security, which will be out soon, hopefully. We'd like to open the floor to some question and answer time, because we do have a great discussion on that. So, thank you very much for listening and for coming, and thank you for your interest in Okinawa.
Thank you.
I'm actually not American, I say I'm actually a Hawaiian citizen.
I guess when I was younger, I had more of, I guess, an identity struggle or identity crisis. But I'm to a point now where I feel pretty comfortable with who I am. I'm proud to be Okinawan, I'm proud to be Native American, even though I'm not as close to that side. Growing up here in Hawaii, it's a very diverse society, right? We have a strong Okinawan community here, so I've been a part of these various communities, and I think via that route, that's how I personally have integrated all of these various cultural heritages in person. So it might seem complicated, but I guess I'm the youngest option in school. That's your question.
Yeah.
You look at the way the current president of the United States
States talks. It's really, it's really direct. It's inflammatory. He has no problem calling people names. And you know, he's really strong in his style of communication. I'm not saying Okinawans or Japanese to go that far in communication styles, but I think having a stronger voice, I think, will help bridge that gap with Western society. Okinawans tend to be so nice, overly nice and passive in talking about this. Even a lot of the Okinawan leaders, political leaders, or leaders in society, when they're talking to U.S. government leaders, I feel like they come across too passive. And America, if they perceive someone to be weak, that's it. You lost them. They're not going to listen. My organization and I were trying to help for psychiatric communication. For you personally, for the individual person, I do recommend being a little stronger, being a little more forceful in talking with, especially with Americans, because that's the only way that they're going to listen. That's the only way they're going to get a picture. Like in 2000, you lost. Yeah. That's your question. The reality is, people who voted were predominantly Okinawan. There weren't too many foreigners who actually voted in this issue. There are some Japanese from Japan who go down to Okinawa to, you know, be part of the
movement.
But they are the vast minority. The majority, the picture that I showed you of the people, the peace protectors, almost everyone in those pictures were Okinawans. They were not Japanese, they were not Chinese, they were not foreigners, they were Okinawans. Most of the leaders of the peace movement are Okinawans. So this is very much an Okinawan
movement.
That's the reality.
アメリカの基地に対して、ね、反対派とか、あの賛成派とか、ちゃんとした情報があのいかないということで、どうなんですかという質問だったんですけど、大体 70% 無心投票という機能でされて、でまあ、ほとんどの人が、あの自由に、まあ、特に変更の方は、もう基地がいらないということを言っているということですね。はい、どうぞ。はい、
ロバートさんのことをその辺野古建設反対の署名活動のことで知って、私も署名させていただいたんですけれども、なんか何万人かに達したら、こうやって合わせて何か言うっていうのが、こうなんか読んだはずなんですけれども、その後、どうなったのか、私は知るではなくて、その後のことをちょっとお聞きしたいんですけれども、その署名活動されたことで何か変わったこと。
She wants to know the update of the petition. She got to learn about you and the organization. So she went ahead and signed it. So she understands that the petition exceeded 20,000, right? So then, is there any update or anything about the White House?
So the rules of the petition, which were set by the White House, said that if the petition gets at least 100,000 signatures within the first 30 days, the White House will issue a response, a guaranteed response. That was the rule set by the White House. We got 100,000 signatures within the first 10 days. We currently have over 211,000 signatures, so we easily surpassed the threshold. Unfortunately, the White House has not responded. It's already almost November, right? And it's almost been a year, and the White House has not responded. My team and I have reached out. We've written to the White House several times, asking for a response. We've never gotten a response. We've also flown to Washington, D.C. and personally met with dozens of representatives, members of Congress, from both Democrats and Republicans. So far, nothing has come out of it. No U.S. politician has been willing to really say on this issue.
And
Yeah, we've spoken with local politicians too. There just hasn't been any. You know, when we speak with them in person, they're very nice and they're very, you know, sympathetic and understanding. But no U.S. politician has been willing to stick their neck on the line, you know, put their career on the line and speak out publicly.
How about other organizations, whether in the United States, Japan, or worldwide?
Yeah, there's a lot of organizations that are very vocal about this, that are very supportive. We work with them closely. Last month in New York City, there was a large peace demonstration with, I think, around 60 other peace organizations. you know, represented there. So that's going very well. Even in Japan, you know, there's quite a bit of support in Japan. There are some Japanese politicians who have spoken out on this issue against the base and in favor of Okinawan people. Unfortunately, the current regime in lobbies, they're not listening. They're just not listening. So, on both sides, the Japanese side and the American side, there's really the governments are just totally ignoring the Okinawan people. They've ignored my petition, they've ignored the Okinawan referendum. But the international community seems to be more supportive, they seem to be more open. So right now, I'm more confident in the international community than I am in either America or Japan.
We are going to polish the altar. If you can help, you can come to the police studio. So, November 24, okay, and 10 o'clock. Okay. And it's 2000.
Instructor coming from Japan, and in the morning there's a lecture, and also in the afternoon